the apostles. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed the Christ to them. With one accord, the crowds paid attention to what was said by Philip when they heard it and saw the signs he was doing. For unclean spirits crying out in a loud voice came out of many possessed people, and many paralyzed or crippled people were cured. There was great joy in the city. Now when the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John, who went down and prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For it had not yet fallen upon any of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sin.
the righteous for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. The word of the Lord.
Spirit and love are two of the words that we hear today that permeate our scripture readings. And so we begin with the Spirit. During this season of Easter, we are celebrating that Jesus has risen from the dead. His disciples have encountered him, they have eaten with him, he has taught them, they have seen his resurrected body. And it's leading us to reflect on this great mystery of our redemption. It is the cornerstone of being a Christian. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, we wouldn't have anything, right? But he did. So it is a game changer. And so Jesus is telling his disciples at the Last Supper that he is going to send an advocate, the Holy Spirit, the promise of the Father. And so as Christians, we receive that Spirit in the waters of baptism. So we said the opening prayer for our sprinkling rite, regeneration. So we are, our corrupted nature is redeemed by the power of the Spirit. So we are seeking to live in the Spirit. So what's your relationship like with the Holy Spirit? So if you notice, Easter will lead us to celebrate Pentecost, and we remember the coming of the Holy Spirit. And then we'll celebrate Trinity Sunday, because the Spirit unites us in union with Jesus. And Jesus introduces us to the Father. So as Christians, we believe one God, three persons. So we celebrate Trinity Sunday. And that leads us to celebrate then the body, most holy body and blood of Christ, this meal right here. And so it starts for us back at Mount Sinai, when the Father, through Moses, led the Israelites out of slavery, gathered them at the mountain, gave them the Ten Commandments, had them build an altar, make a sacrifice, and sprinkle them with the blood of the sacrifice to be sealed in the covenant. And that was made manifest in the Passover meal that the Jewish people celebrate even today, to remember how God has saved them. Which then brings us to this liturgy, which we call the Divine Liturgy, because it has the same elements that they had at Mount Sinai. Huh? We are gathered by God, the power of the Spirit. We listen to the Word, the instruction, to the Scriptures, and we are sprinkled with water, the sign that we are sealed with the covenant, and we enter a new sacrifice, a new Passover in Jesus. It has come to fulfillment in Him. And we receive His body and His blood. And it is the Spirit that then lives within us, that unites us to Him, that we see Him. We see Him in one another. During Mass, we'll say, let us offer one another a sign of peace. What are we doing in that moment? We are recognizing the presence of Jesus, the risen Christ, and those around us. And so as we come to this divine liturgy, it is a movement of the Spirit. So an invitation for us is to be rooted in the Spirit who dwells within us in a very personal way. Peter reminds us in the second reading that we are called to make known this relationship with kindness. So how do you make known a relationship with God? Well, if we think about it, the invitation for us is to think about it in simple terms, like a friend. Do you have a good friend? Think about who your good friend is. Typically, you would say your good friend is someone who knows you. Maybe someone who knows you in ways that other people don't know you. Your good friend is someone who's always with you, who's going to be there by your side, right? And so we think about God in this type of context. The Spirit is our friend. The Spirit is always there for us. The Spirit knows us completely. In all our good and in all our bad. And just like a good friend, He still loves us, right? Because that's how God's love is. It's forever. And I don't know about you, but for my journey, that started with the reading of the Bible. So we talked about in the opening prayer, we heard the words heartfelt devotion. It means we are to bring our heart, our whole being, our level of feeling into our relationship with God. It should be heartfelt, not empty. A relationship is not heartfelt, it's sort of a sterile, empty relationship. But a relationship that is heartfelt is full of power and passion and purpose. And so we are to bring a heartfelt devotion to our relationship to God. The reading of the Bible, if you start with the Holy Spirit, you ask the Holy Spirit, the advocate who leads you, to help you to hear God's saving word for you when you read those scripture passages, they will come. As He is risen, that He will begin to speak to you in your daily life. He will lift you up. He will feed you, nourish you, and sustain you. When you come for adoration and you pray for the Blessed Sacrament, ask the Holy Spirit to fill you up and to unite you deeper in your union with Christ. Maybe you're reading a daily reflection as Scripture quotes to it or something. When you pray the rosary, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our advocate. It is the action of the Spirit that really leads us in that union with Jesus. So start with the Holy Spirit. The Spirit will lead you to that deeper union with Him, that you can begin to know Him more fully, His divine love for you, and in that you are called to bring that message into the world. That's our challenge. That's our mission as the church. We have been redeemed and saved over and over again. So we are on a journey from the baptisms of regeneration to be reborn over and over again as we grow and mature, always clinging to the power of God's divine mercy and love for us. That's what we celebrate today. And so Jesus is trying to remind His disciples to not be worried. He'll be with them always. That He's going to send an advocate to be with them, and that He will live within them, and they will live in Him. What a beautiful image He gives us elsewhere in John, that He is the vine, we are the branches. He is our source. Not only is He promising us this life now, but as we see this life passing away, we experience suffering and death and things in our life, we are in a relationship where we believe God is creating for us a world forever called the Kingdom of God, where there'll be no more pain, no more suffering, no more death, no more tears. And so we are beginning to live in that world now as He transforms us and saves us over and over again. And so as we come to the table today, let us come in the power of the Spirit. Let us be fed and nourished and filled with every fiber of our being in the presence of God. Think about it. You are receiving the Word as become flesh in your hearing. Now you're about to receive Jesus, the banquet of the Eucharist, so that every fiber of your being is filled with the presence of God. Not only individually, but collectively, as church, as the body of Christ, to go out into the world this week and to make known this friendship, this relationship with our Savior, so that the world may come to believe that Jesus is truly the Savior of the world. So Jesus made it simple for us. He reduced all the commandments down to two. Love God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. If we do these two commandments, He will live in us, we will live in Him, and He will lead us to make known the good news this week in our relationship.